Hello everyone, welcome back for the second lesson of Basics of Deep Learning. So this is a slide of lesson one, where we saw the deep learning pipeline, with the dataset and data loader on the left, your model in the middle, the label with the loss on the right. And for the last lecture, what we did is we played with a pre-trained VGG networks. And you did play with a ResNet network for the practicals, so that you used all the different steps of the deep learning pipeline for one example. And again, it's completely fine if you did not understand precisely what was happening for each step. And today, we'll start seeing one of these steps more precisely. So this course will be a bit more technical than the first one. And we will focus on the red arrow here, how you are updating the weight of your classifier when you are making predictions. So again, what we did last time is a course overview and a description of the machine learning pipeline. And today, we will see what are tensors in PyTorch and how PyTorch is dealing with automatic differentiation. In order to see this, we will jump directly to the Jupyter notebook, which is open here in Google Colab. So for this notebook, we will not use the full power of GPUs, so it's completely fine if you are running this notebook on CPU instead of GPU. So what is a PyTorch tensor? Let's have a look at the documentation here of PyTorch. So a torch tensor is a multidimensional matrix containing elements of a single data type. So if you are familiar with a NumPy library in Python, torch tensor is the equivalent of NumPy if you want to use GPUs. So the only constraint you have is you will deal with matrix of high dimension, and all the entries of the matrix will have the same types. And here are the different types that are allowed in PyTorch. So you have floating points here, so real number if you want, integer here, and the 32 bits, 64 bits tell you what is the precision you can get for the representation of this number in the system. If you want to know more about types, you can ask for info with this torch F info for floating numbers and I info for integers. Okay. So from what you need to know about types is basically the types tells you how numbers are represented on your computer. You don't need to know much more than this on types, but we'll see that you have to be a little bit careful in order to avoid some perhaps weird bugs in your code. So let's start with creating a 3x5 matrix with PyTorch tensor. So I'm creating an empty one here. You see that these are arbitrary numbers, almost all zeros actually. And the default type is a float with a 32 bits precision. If instead of arbitrary number you want samples from a distribution, let's say a Gaussian distribution with zero mean and unit variance, you can ask for the function randn. Okay, n is for normal distribution, which is the name of the Gaussian distribution. And you obtain an array of size 3x5 with random sample in it. So something you will do a lot in PyTorch is looking at what are the sizes of your matrix, because you will deal with high dimensional matrix, not only two dimensional like here. And in order to get this information, you can ask for the method size. Okay, it turns out that this returns actually a tuple. So if you don't know what a tuple is, you can just click here and see the documentation. You see that the documentation here, it's not the documentation of PyTorch. it's the standard documentation of Python, and this is because the tuples that is returned by this size method is exactly a Python tuple. As you can see here, when I'm asking for the test, is the x size equal to the tuple 3.5, comma 5. Okay. So most of the time, what you want to do is do your deep learning work on GPUs, so using PyTorch Tensor. And once you get the results, you want to go back to the standard NumPy library in Python. So you need to bridge your results from Tensor to NumPy. For example, if you want to use standard machine learning algorithm like the one developed in the scikit-learn library, you need to have NumPy array as input. So here is the easiest way to get a NumPy array from your tensor. So by using the method .numpy, and you see that you obtain exactly this array, but now as a NumPy array. And you can use your standard algorithm on NumPy array with it. Now, like plot or anything. Now, if you want to do the opposite, you want to take a NumPy array and create a torch tensor, you can use the method torch from NumPy, and A here is an array of ones of size 5. And what you can see is that the type of B, it's not the default type of a tensor, which was torch float 32. It's now the type of the NumPy array. So A was of an array of type float 64. So now your tensor obtained by this torch from NumPy is a tensor with types torch.float.float 64. Okay, so here I will describe you one thing where you will see you need to be careful with types. Okay, these ones are real numbers for the computer. Let's try to translate them into integer. In order to do that, I'm using this long method. So you see that the first line here is a C tensor. So it contains ones again, but the types is int with 64 bytes precision. For B, I did not modify it. So these are also ones, but of type float tensor. Now let's take a 3x5 matrix of tensor. So here again, the default type is float 32. And I get this number. The first operation I will do, I will add the B tensor with this new 3x5 tensor. But remember that the type of XR, the first one, is float 33, and the type of B is float 64. So what happened? Okay. So he did the operation correctly, apparently, because he added ones everywhere. And now the type is float 64. Okay, so the maximal precision one. Now I'm doing the same thing, but I'm adding types float 32 with types int 64. I'm obtaining a new result, and you see that apparently it did the right thing. This looks like the same numbers, but let's check if this is true. Okay, you see that when I'm asking the computer if these two tensors are the same, sometimes they are, sometimes they are not. So in order to understand what happened, for example, these two numbers should be different. In order to see this, I will set the precision when I'm printing my tensor to 10 floating points. So now the first entry of my first result is this one, and the first entry of the second is this one. And you see that these two numbers actually are not the same. They start differing after this digit over there. So now, what is the true result, if you want? Remember, I'm adding ones to this tensor. So it looks like the true result is actually this one. Okay, the B one. So when I added the C, which was cast to an int type, you see that as a result, I will not obtain the same result as if I didn't cast this to an int and keep it as a float number. So this is a source of a lot of bugs, and even though you don't need to know much about types, you need to remember you have to be careful when using them, and in order to avoid such perhaps weird result at first. Okay, something which is also very important in this example is you see that I added a tensor of size 3 by 5 with a tensor of size 5. How is that possible? This is what is called broadcasting. And again, this is not something which is specific to PyTorch. So broadcasting is described here for the NumPy library. And here is what is happening. So if one tensor has fewer dimensions than the other, it will reshape it by adding as many dimensions of size 1 as necessary and in the front. And then, for every mismatch, if one of the two tensors is 1, then it's expanded along this axis. So let's see how it works on a perhaps easier example. So here I'm taking A, which is a tensor of size 4 by 1. Okay, with 1, 2, 3, 4. And B, which is a tensor of size 1 by 5, which is 5 minus 5, 5 minus 5, 5. Then I'm adding these two tensors. So you see that according to the broadcasting rule, the algorithm, what it will do is it will expand the one dimension here, which is in front of the 5 dimension of the second tensor, to make it a 4 by 5 matrix, and it will expand the first dimension of B to make it a 4 by 5 matrix. And now you will have two 4 by 5 matrices, and you will be able to expand them. So C is this one, and if you want to understand what happened, this is my first matrix, so which is represented by a column, 1, 2, 3, 4. And this should be a B. This is a second matrix, which is a line column. And in order to sum them, it will expand the first matrix by concatenating 5 different columns with the same numbers. And it will expand the second one, so again, this should be a B here, into 4 different lines with the same entries. And now, A, this matrix and this matrix are the same, and you can sum them entry-wise to get this number. And this is exactly the result you obtain here. Okay, so broadcasting is very important because it's used a lot in PyTorch, and it allows you to make very fast computation without relying on a for loop, for example. So let's see one other thing you need to be careful with. So here is my two tensor with random Gaussian entries. They have the same size, so I can sum them. They are 3 by 4. So if I want to get the result of the sum of the two tensors, and I want to put it in the X tensor, here is one way to do it. So I'm using the method add, and you see what is important here is the small underscore at the end of add. So each time you have this underscore at the end of a method, this means that you are modifying actually the tensor x. So you see that now x was equal to this tensor here, x are to this one. Now when I'm printing x, this is the sum of the two. So I did modify the x tensor. So there are a lot of methods where you have an underscore like this. For example, the one which are very commonly used are fill, when you want to fill a tensor with something, an underscore y, t, which is a transpose, and this will change the tensor x. So here is the transpose of x, okay, but there is no underscore here, so I did not modify x. I'm just printing the output of the transposition of x. Now here I want to modify it, and then I'm printing the new tensor x. So the transposition is done here in place, and now the new value is given with this array. I am obtaining the same result here and here. Okay, so be careful when you have an underscore like this. This means you are modifying your tensor. Something else that you need to be a bit careful with is explained with this code. Okay, so I'm starting with, again, a numpy array of ones of size 5. This is A. I'm translating this as a tensor. This is B. Now I'm modifying the third entry of A and make it 0. Okay, and I'm printing the tensor B. So you see that modifying the numpy array results in a modified version of the tensor 2. And the reverse is also true. If I'm modifying the tensor B, so this is now a 5, I'm printing the numpy array, I see it's modified. So it's very easy to understand why this is true. It's because, and it's explained here, it's because when you are using this torch from NumPy, actually the torch tensor and the NumPy array are sharing the same memory. So if you are modifying one of them, it will impact the other. So here is share the same memory. It's written here in the documentation. Okay. So you have to be careful with that. So I didn't give an example here of slicing for tensor, because these are exactly the same rules are for NumPy. For example, here, if you want to have access to the fourth number of B, you just ask for B of 3. Remember that index in Python are starting with 0, so it's 0, 1, 2, 3. So it will modify this one. Okay. Okay, the only part where we will be using the GPU is here. So let's say the CUDA is available. So this means that my runtime is on GPU. You can check this also here. Okay, I'm on GPU. So now I will just show you how you put so everything I did before was done on CPU. Now I want to put my tensor on GPU, and this is very easy to do. We did it last time. So the first thing you define is the device. So here I want to use the device CUDA. So I want to use the GPU. Let's see if X is on the device. Okay. Okay, so here the X is stored on the device, which is the CPU. So if you want to create a new tensor and put it on the GPU, here is something you can do. It's just X to device. So now in this small loop, I'm checking whether CUDA is available or not. I'm creating a once of the same shape as x, remember it was 3 by 4, on the GPU. So x here is on the CPU, so if I want to make the sum of x plus y, the first thing I need to do is move x to GPU, then do the sum, and now I'm printing z, the result here. And so this is the result. You see that it's on the device CUDA, and the type is torch.cuda.floatTensor. Okay, because if you look here at the types, you see that you have one type on the CPU, one type on the GPU, and the main difference is you are adding a .cuda here. So this is what's happening for the first result. And now if you want to bring back your result from the GPU to the CPU, you just use two CPU and you can even change the type here. Okay. The last thing, I'm taking a random number, Gaussian of size 1, I'm putting it on the GPU, and you see here easy way to get the NumPy version of it. So what you should you see that x is actually on the device, it's a tensor of size 1. If you are asking x.item, which is the most useful function in order to get directly the scalar from a tensor, so the tensor is of size 1, so x.item will give you exactly the entry of the scalar. If you want to get a NumPy array, you go to CPU and then ask for a NumPy. That's it. So now you know how to create tensors from, let's say, NumPy array. You know how to put this on CUDA, on GPUs. So once it's on GPUs, you can do all the operation allowed by PyTorch on the GPU directly. And at the end, you can come back to CPU and translate it to NumPy array. Something which is also very convenient in PyTorch is that you have access to a whole bunch of datasets. So here I'm using a dataset we did not discuss so far. It's a Cypher 10 dataset. So if you want to have a look, here is a description of the Cypher 10 dataset on the PyTorch documentation. So you see that I'm asking the data in Cypher, what is the shape? Okay, so the shape is 50,000 by 32 by 32 by 3. So if you know Cypher 10, these are, and you can guess it from the shape, 50,000 images of size 32 by 32 in colors. So the three here are for the channels corresponding to the colors. Okay. So here I'm doing a small permutation. So if you want to know what permutation is doing, you just go here. Where is the permutation? Permut here, sorry. The dimension of this vector. Okay. So it will, here, what will be the result? I'm permuting, so the first coordinate is keep the same. And then I'm basically moving the third component, so these three in second position. And then one and two, so this one and this one as the last coordinate. So I'm obtaining something of size 50,000, the number of images, times 3, the channels for color, times 32 by 32. Okay, let's see if I want, for example, the 48 first images. So I'm using the narrow, which will narrow this dimension of x. So the zeroth dimension is the first one, so the number of images. And I'm starting with the first image and taking 48 images. So what is the shape? It should be 48 by 3 by 32 by 32. And now a small visualization of the images. So these are my 48 first images in my dataset. Okay, let's do a last small modification of these images. I'm killing the green and blue channels, and I'm obtaining images which are in red. Okay, exactly the same images as above, but not in colors anymore, in red.